Well, let me thank you for joining me for the Wednesday edition of Lunch with the Pastor, and thanks for joining with me today. I want to talk about spiritual growth and what that looks like, because it is important that each of us are growing in our faith and maturing in our faith. And the Bible gives us some pretty good instruction about sort of the keys to it. If you able to watch the services on Sunday or attend First Baptist on Sundays, I've been working through that on through Ephesians, and recognizing that because of who we are in Christ and our position in Christ, we have the power of the Holy Spirit, the indwelling presence of Christ, and we have the fullness of the person of the Father in us. Well, part of understanding how to grow spiritually has to do with understanding the ultimate end of spiritual growth. And I think that's where sometimes people get into trouble, and especially when you're trying to grow, and then you wonder, well, I'm trying to grow. Why is it that I'm struggling here, or why is it that I seem to be failing here? Well, I think sometimes it's because of the fact that our ultimate aim is incorrect. 2 Peter 3:18 says, "Grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory for now and forever. Amen." And I think what Simon Peter is saying, you find these verses or this idea in a lot of other verses, but the ultimate end of the Christian life and the ultimate end of our spiritual growth is to be the glory of God. That when people look at our life, and as a result of what's happened in us and our spiritual growth, is that people exalt God, that people give praise and glory to God. And I think that's the understanding of when he says to him be the glory, that it's dealing with that the exaltation be given to God. And not because God is some kind of egomaniac, but because of understanding who he is and what position he holds, because he is creator, because he is God. We want the exaltation to go to him, and it also keeps us into better focus. Now realize what God has provided for you. It's realizing that we are complete in him. I love Colossians chapter 2, verse 9 says, "For in Christ the whole fullness of the deity dwells bodily, and you have been filled in him who is the head of all rule and authority." Paul was dealing with the issue of the deities, that there's a million deities out there, and they all make up what divine is, and Paul uses that sort of in a way to criticize and to negate what they're saying, to say that in Christ all of the fullness of God dwells, meaning that Christ is fully and completely God. Well, then the fullness of God and Christ is in us. And so what we need to live the Christian life is there. 2 Peter 1:3, we used 2 Peter 3:18, but 2 Peter 1:3 says that all the things that pertain to life and godliness we have available. And then Ephesians 1:3 says that we have been given all spiritual blessings that are in the heavenlies. All of these things are ours. So everything that you need is provided for you to live the Christian life. But where I think we mess up is this is where the ego comes in. I think of Philippians chapter 2, where Paul's description of Jesus as he went to the cross, he says he humbled himself. That though he was equal with God, all that God is, there was nothing wrong in the declaration of his deity and recognizing that Christ is fully and completely God. And yet in all of that, he humbled himself. And what I'm afraid is the reason why we struggle with spiritual growth is, one, it's very, very difficult. It doesn't come easily. But those that want to pay the price or those that want to work toward it, oftentimes where they stumble is because it becomes a very prideful thing. I want to grow spiritually so I can be a leader in the church. Even the term leadership that we use, it means that I'm kind of in charge. I'm the boss. I'm the one that everybody looks to, that I'm the one who gets the credit and the recognition. When we think about spiritual leadership or becoming deeply spiritual, it's so that I can become a great teacher so that people will, you know, recognize me, so I can, you know, write these books or speak at these conferences or go and do these things, get promoted in these ways. And you're around people like that. And for some, you guys reject spiritual growth because you say, I don't want to be that way. And that's the wrong motivation. The other side is sometimes we want that. And really, the motivation is pridefulness and it's not humility. So here's what I challenge you to do. When you think of spiritual growth, don't let the mistakes of others keep you from growing spiritually. But secondly, make sure that you check your motives. Why is it that you want to grow in your knowledge of Christ? Why is it that, as Simon Peter says, to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord? Why do you want to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord? Well, it's one reason. This is why. We want to do it so that God is glorified in us. That when people see us, they hear our words, they see our works. When they hear our teaching, that they don't look to us and say, man, isn't that the greatest person you've ever heard or ever met? But it's that they see us and they say, man, isn't our God a great God? Focus on the glory of God today. Grow in your faith. Make that commitment, but make sure that your motive, your reason, is that God would be glorified in you. You have a great day today.